Entropy is a quantifiable physical property that is associated with one of three concepts: a state of disorder, randomness, or uncertainty. Depending on what you're studying or what branch of basic sciences, math, physics, or chemistry you're using, entropy can be defined slightly different. Whatever the case may be, entropy is closely related to the unavailability of a system's thermal energy for conversion into mechanical work. A simple example can show how a property that measures uncertainty, like entropy does, works. If a substance's molecules can be in only one of two different locations for case 1, or they can be in one of four different locations for case 2, we could state that there is a lower uncertainty about their location for case 1. If the position of the molecules represented entropy, we could say that the entropy of the substance in case 2 is higher. Of course, it's a bit more complex than that, and from a statistical perspective, it can get really complicated. You would learn Boltzmann entropy expression with Boltzmann constant and an omega term for probability. Fortunately for us, for a Thermo 1 course, we'll focus on entropy as a property that can be used to figure out process and cycle inputs and outputs. So let's see how we can define entropy for this purpose. A high-temperature thermal reservoir is connected to a reversible heat engine, which produces work and dumps some of the heat to another system that has a temperature T. And let's do this with differentials delta QH, delta Q, and delta W reversible. This second system will be producing work, delta W system, out of the heat it receives, without dumping any heat anywhere else. Of course, we already know that this system does not exist in the real world. The whole reason we studied heat engines was because we realized that we can add work to generate heat, but we cannot just add heat to produce work. The only way to produce work from heat is by having a more elaborate system like the heat engine. If we write the energy conservation equation for this impossible system, we'd get dE is equal to delta QH minus delta WC, where delta WC is the total work out. Because the heat engine is reversible, we know that delta QH over TH is equal to delta Q over T. Remember that we derived this expression and even used it in the expression for efficiency during the last lecture? Link below if you don't. From this, we can substitute delta QH with TH delta Q over T. If we define a cyclic integral as the integral over the entire cycle, and we take the cyclic integral of the left-hand side, since the substance returns to the same initial state after one cycle, this term would be equal to zero. On the right, we'd have the cyclic integral of TH dQ over T and of delta WC, which is just WC. And since the reservoirs usually maintain their temperature, TH is constant and can be taken outside of the integral. And now, since we know that this system cannot exist, we know that the combined work cannot be greater than zero. And therefore, the cyclic integral cannot be greater than zero. Remember that the temperature is in Kelvin, so it will always be positive. This is called the Clausius inequality. The integral is exactly zero for completely reversible processes, and lower than zero for real, irreversible processes. Now think about this. The cyclic integral of any property we have will be zero. D volume, D enthalpy, D internal energy. Any of these after a full cycle would go back to their original value, meaning that they gained or lost a zero value. So for reversible processes, and these can just be internally reversible processes, where the cyclic integral is zero, what's inside the integral must also be a property. And this is what we call entropy. Extensive as capital S in kilojoules over Kelvin. So just like we've done with all of the other properties so far, we can integrate dS between states 1 and 2 and get S2 minus S1, or just delta S, or even the integral of delta Q over T. There is applications for calculating the integral mathematically, but for Thermo 1, we'll focus on the tabulated data. You've seen this before in property tables. Now, if we rearrange the dS equation, we can write delta Q equal to TdS and integrate it. So just like we've used TV diagrams and PV diagrams in the past, we'll now start to use TS diagrams. Because if we have an internally reversible process from 1 to 2, we can take the area under the curve to determine the heat transfer. This is just like using the work expression W equal to the integral of PdV. Let's say we have a piston cylinder system that operates isothermally when adding heat. Since it's isothermal and therefore at least internally reversible, The heat would be equal to T times delta S, or S2 minus S1. And if we think about what we said earlier, where do you think there's a higher chance for uncertainty or disorder? At state 1 or at state 2? Well, even just from the fact that the volume is larger in 2, the possibilities for the arrangement of the substance is higher at 2. And this is consistent with our expression. S2 is higher than S1, and that's why the heat is going to be positive. We need to add heat to go from 1 to 2. Now let's go back to the Clausius inequality, because we said that for real processes, this cyclic integral is always lower than 0. If we consider a cycle from 1 to 2 and from 2 to 1, we can make the assumption that at least one of the two will occur in the direction where the second law tells us it's natural for it to happen, so we can think of it as internally reversible. It can be 1 to 2 or 2 to 1, it doesn't matter. Since we established that for a reversible process the integral is just delta S, and the sum of the two integrals is less than 0, we get that S2 minus S1 is greater than the integral from 1 to 2. This means that the entropy change of the system is greater than the entropy transfer due to heat. What this means is that there must be an entropy generation every time we run the cycle. Basically, that to make this inequality an equation, we would be adding an entropy generation term that is always positive. So this is very important to understand. In real processes, there is always entropy generation, but that doesn't mean that from state 1 to state 2, the entropy is always increasing. We can still have the entropy change be negative. We can have entropy decrease between states. We have no problem with that. It just means that for a real process, there is always entropy generation, and that entropy generation term is always positive. There are simple examples that we can use to prove that when comparing irreversible versus reversible processes, the difference is the entropy generation, and that that generation is always positive. But we'll elaborate more on it when we cover exergy. More on that in a later lecture. For now, just know that entropy is always generated for irreversible real processes. Now let's look at how we can use entropy as a property by either looking at tabulated values, or just like we did to get to internal energy and enthalpy, by using specific heats. There are several differences with some tables and the process to get to entropy with specific heat values, so we'll study that in the next lecture. We'll finish this lecture by first going over what has not changed between the previous properties that we've used so far, and 2, how to use the tables for water, which is also applicable for refrigerant tables. And in the next lecture, we'll study the differences for the tables of other substances, and also learn how to use specific heats to get to entropy. The main characteristic that hasn't changed much is the property diagrams we use. We'll be using TS diagrams more than TV diagrams, but like I said, they're very similar. We still have a dome, and constant pressure lines look very much the same. And if we increase pressure, we go up. We still have SF for saturated liquid, and SG for saturated vapor. And we can still use the quality expressions with these. And finally, we can still use liquid approximations. As for goal 2, this is simple. All you need to know is that for water and refrigerant tables, you have the specific entropy values, and you can just use them directly as you've always used specific volume, specific internal energy, and specific enthalpy. That's about it. So let's look at a short example where we make use of our water tables to find entropy, and if you want to check more complex examples, make sure to check out the links I've left in the description below. A piston cylinder contains 0.2 kilograms of saturated liquid water at 95 degrees Celsius. It is now boiled to become saturated vapor in a reversible process. What is the work and the heat transfer using the energy equation, and what is the heat transfer using the entropy definition? Are they the same? As usual, try to answer these questions yourself before watching this solution. To answer these two first questions, you know exactly what to do. You've done calculations like these since the 6th lecture of this course. The work is defined as the integral of PdV, and since the pressure is constant in a regular piston cylinder device, and we're going from a saturated liquid to a saturated vapor, the pressure will be the saturation pressure at 95 degrees Celsius, and we can simplify the integral as just constant P times the change in volume, or even just P times M times the change in specific volume. And for the heat, we can calculate it in two ways. We can just look at the change in enthalpy, since again, this is a constant pressure process, or we can add the change in internal energy to the work we just calculated. Let's go with the first option since it's just the enthalpy values. We look up the saturation pressure for 95C, the specific volumes with V1 being saturated liquid VF and V2 being saturated vapor VG, and also the specific enthalpy values HF for H1 and HG for H2. We substitute the values and find a work value equal to 33.5 kilojoules and a heat transfer value equal to 453.9 kilojoules. Now, since one of the versions of our definition of entropy was that the heat is the integral of temperature dS, and in this specific case the temperature is indeed constant, the integral results in a very similar expression as the work. Work equals P delta V and Q equals T delta S. Therefore, Q is T times M times the change in specific entropy S2 minus S1, or SG minus SF. We look up those values in the table, and we substitute the temperature, always in Kelvin, and the mass and the entropies, to find a heat transfer value of 453.9 kilojoules, which is awfully close to what we had obtained before. Of course, when the temperature is not constant, the integral that defines entropy might have to be carried out, and therefore we're not always just looking for S values from a table. But we'll get to that in the next lecture video. To watch that lecture, and most importantly, other examples on this topic, make sure to check out the links I left in the description of this video. There, you'll find the links to other lectures of the thermodynamics course, and the playlists with all the lectures for some other engineering courses. Thanks for watching!